I love this one. I can't get over it. I mean, this is, you really need to look at this for a while to... This is Max Beckman. When I was at Harvard, I might have already gone to MIT, but they had a big Max Beckman retrospective at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. And Perry Rathbone, who was the director of the museum, was a Max Beckman patron. He brought Beckman to St. Louis when he had been there. Beckman was a great German expressionist painter, artist, probably the greatest for my money. And I was studying with Eric Erickson at the time. He was my thesis advisor. And Eric Erickson was the major theoretician of human identity. He was famous for coining the term the identity crisis. And he had a massively great monograph called Identity and the Life Cycle. And he told me when I mentioned the exhibit that he actually had started out as an artist in Germany and had his first exhibit with Max Beckman. But what fascinated me about Beckman is that there were probably 30 self-portraits in the exhibit. He was a great self-portrait painter, you know, like Rembrandt, who was also so famous for his self-portraits all the way through his career, same with Beckman. So you could go through this whole guy's life and look at his depiction of himself at various stages in the life cycle, and that's what Erickson was famous for, theoretician of the life cycle. And so I went so often I got to know Rathbone, who I don't know, it just happened. He was on the floor in the exhibit at the time, and we were introduced, and I told him I was a student from Harvard. I was teaching at MIT, and I did a review of the show for the Harvard Crimson. And so he told me that Mrs. Beckman, whose nickname was Quappy, was coming from New York, and we ought to meet her. So he invited us to their home, and we met Quappy, and then she invited us to New York to see her paintings. And at that time, she took me to her gallery dealer, Catherine Viviano, who brought out 5 Beckman lithographs that were about this high and about this wide. And they were from a series that he had done called Hell, which he did after he came out of the First World War, where he had been an ambulance driver. Or was it the Second World War?
Who?
Must have been the Second World War. Beckman. Yeah, it was the Second World War. And he suffered a nervous breakdown at the front as an ambulance driver. And so this series called Hell was an expression of his state of mind at the time and the collapse of Germany. So I bought them. She said, you want to buy them? I said, well, you know, I knew I could borrow money from Harvard at 1% interest a year. It was like free money. I should have borrowed more and invested it. Anyhow, I borrowed the money from Harvard, and we had these in our possession for many years. I just sold them a couple years ago at Sotheby's. So that's my Beckman connection. So I got to be very enamored of his work. He has a great triptych at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. If you ever go, you got to make sure to look at it, called Departure.
I think it was in the First World
War. Was it?
Ernest Hemingway was a driver.
I guess it was the First World War.
He died in 1950.
Yeah, that's right. And Hitler, he had to leave because of Hitler.
So he was a driver on the German side.
It was the First World War, yeah, okay. On the German side.
So is that a lithograph?
Probably. It's a little hard to tell, isn't it? I think it is. He did a lot of prints. And so it was a great thrill to be able to have his work for that many years. And here's his Odysseus sailing past the sirens. Now, let me remind you that this is rational self-consciousness in its embryonic stage, going past the mythical powers. And you could take this as an expression of the transition from myth to philosophy, which is the big theme of this course. They play it both ways, in the sense that early Greek philosophy is a complete departure from the myth, because they're starting to think on their own in concepts that are not mythical in principle, They're not symbolic imagery like the mythical symbols are. So you get a kind of translation from mythical symbol to rational concept with the origins of philosophy. And there are a number of figures, scholars, who take that line. And they're usually the guys that try to argue that early Greek philosophy is the beginning of science, which for them is enlightenment. Namely, you're thinking, you're not blowing smoke. And that's the great gain of the transition from myth to logic, from myth to philosophy. And there are other thinkers who I tend to side with who see more of a transition rather than a break. And where the myth continues and is in a way compatible to the rational concepts. There's still, I mean, I don't know if you want to call them quasi-logic, quasi-mythical or what, but the transition isn't that abrupt, and in fact, one of the great aspects of the Platonic dialogues are the Platonic myths, even though they're philosophical myths, and Plato is quite explicit about that. So, that's that theme. I forgot to tell you about the Homeric question. You could Google it, if you would. And it's about the scholarly attention that was given to the Homeric epics in the 19th century in Germany, when scholarly criticism of ancient documents came to the forefront. It was mirrored also by biblical criticism. There was a tremendous development of scholarly criticism of the biblical texts. And they were very comparable, because what they did with the Bible is to indicate that there were any number of sources that went into the composition of the Old Testament. And they finally determined that there were four major sources that were given the initial J-E-P-D. The Yahwist and the Elohist, both different names for God. So you had a Yahwist text in the Old Testament. You had an Elohist text that could be distinguished according to their respective styles, and the Deuteronomist, and the priestly writer. So the humorous saying that came up was, the first five books of the Bible are not by Moses, but they are a mosaic. And the comparable thing happened to Homer. That the Homeric poems, especially the Iliad, were a composite. You know, and probably the leading document to lift off initially is the so-called Catalog of Ships. I forget which book it appears in, but all of a sudden there's this long list of all the ships that came to Troy. And, you know, it looks like it's just stuck in there. Well, so they started picking it apart. And the argument was that you had all of these lays, you know, L-A-Y-S, like songs that circulated about the Trojan War, and that some sort of, you know, symbolic figure called Homer put them together, and we have the Iliad and the Odyssey. But they're really a mixed composite of all of these stories that previously had circulated separately, and they were finally put together. And it could have been, you know, any number of authors or composers or singers who did this until it was set down as a literary text. So the joke at Harvard was, the Iliad and the Odyssey were not by Homer, but by somebody else with the same name. That's as funny as it got at Harvard. So now that's swung around again, where, you know, the unity of the Iliad and the Odyssey is, for me, so evident. And that's why I gave you what I consider to be the thematic unifying theme of the Iliad, namely the prophecy that Achilles has to die, and that he has to face his death after he tries to cheat it, and that this is one definitely unifying theme of the Iliad. And the Odyssey is, in a way, obviously coherent in its own right. So there's been a trend to go back to a unitary author whose name was Homer. So I still am keen about spending a little time, which I want to do today, on this. I didn't adequately discuss this with you, and I want to do it today. You've got, you know, the respective pages by Rietzler about this, but I want to go through some of the things he says in order to prepare you for Parmenides' chariot ride to the mystery of being. If I can make clear to you what Rietzler does with this simple text, this simile of Homer, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 lines, I can set you up and show you the transition to Parmenides' experience in confronting or encountering the mystery of being. I set you up a little bit for that with the issue of Telemachus, the son of Odysseus, taking a chariot ride to the kingdom of Menelaus to get some information about his father. Well, who knows if he's my father? And I asked you if you had ever had a doubt about your paternity, and many of you raised your hands, which still surprises me. And I tried to indicate that that's the original example of the shock of non-being, the doubt over one's paternity. So if you can make the move from the doubt over your paternity to the shock of non-being, you're on the way. Now we want to make the move from what Rietzler says about this simile to the chariot ride of Parmenides. And what he says is, I mean, he's just amazing how he struggles with the effort to show you how this is revelatory of the being of Penelope. Now, it's hard to get to the being of anything. And I think, first of all, because we don't talk that way, as if there was some deep mystery about everything. For us, things are basically superficial, you know, on the surface. What's the mystery? Whereas for the Greeks, the mystery was paramount. One of the ways to get a good grasp of that is to realize that Aristotle says philosophy begins in wonder. He makes wonder the original attitude for philosophy. The Greek word is taumazein. T-H-A-U-M-A-Z-E-I-N. Google that. And think of... Huh? T-H-A-U-M-A-Z-E-I-N. And the Z is pronounced as a D. Taumazein. And philosophy begins in wonder for Aristotle. Okay, by the time you get to Descartes, where the whole thing shifts around after Galileo, as I've mentioned before, what does philosophy begin with? Do you know?
A question?
Huh?
A question?
Well, but behind that, that's
doubt.
I mean, get the difference. See, with Descartes, it's all mind. Cogito ergo sum, I think. So it's become so centered in intellection, what we call cognition. And every time I say that word, I hear an automobile starting up. You know, as if cognition is comparable to ignition. And so that's how reduced in meaning the Greek wonder and the bewilderment before what is has been transformed as the basis of what then eventuates as modern science. So I was right about the archaic smile. I mean, that's my unique contribution to teaching this material. I don't think anybody else in the country would have any disquisition on the archaic smile as the background for the rise of rational self-consciousness. And I was thinking about it today, that the smile is really the period in Greece where being is manifest. What are they smiling about? Being. And that's what Heidegger means about disclosure. What's manifest is still hidden. That's the enigma of the archaic smile. And so I love the notion that you add an I and you get a simile, from smile to simile. So in a way, the archaic smile shines through this simile of Homer as the unitive third thing that Rietzler talks about. What's the third thing? He calls it the tertium comparationis. You don't have to get stuck on the Latin phrase. It's a technical, critical, literary term. It means the basis for making the comparison. And he's amazing at how wonderfully he describes all that. The interpreters usually look first for the so-called third thing. They pick out one or several such tertia. Both snow and skin are white. Water and tears flow. Wind and mood change. Yeah, see, we don't have the critical faculty to make those moves when we read something like this. We just go by it. I mean, so, okay, the wind is blowing and the snow is melting and Penelope's weeping. So what? We don't have the critical means to pause to examine and analyze this simile the way Rietzler does, to get it to disclose what he says it does. That's why this is maybe the most precious piece of literary criticism I've ever encountered in my entire life. And I told you before, it's because of this essay that I'm teaching this class. That's why I thought I'd done it kind of short shrift and want to pick it up again as we go on to study the pre-Socratics and especially Parmenides. These tertia illustrate what? The tertia give the stimmung. Okay. Google that, please. Stimmung. 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 It's usually translated as mood. It's the thymic field, folks. That's what the Germans express in the word Stimmung. It's also translated as tuning. So it has a musical character, but it's here. It's our moods, it's our emotions. It's our being in the world with the kind of attitudes that we have. So Stimmung is the term he resorts to, being German himself, to talk about what the tertium gives expression to. The tertia give the Stimmung when they mean the whole of an emotional atmosphere that cannot be put into words. And he goes on and on like that throughout this essay about what can't be said and yet is expressed. It shines through. And what he does in his analysis is to show you what's shining on the basis of this tertium, this unity of terms that account for the simile and make it possible for the comparison to occur. The comparison encompasses the whole of Penelope's fate, past and future, in one visible picture. Now you get that? Our very eyes, looking at mountains, snow, and brooks, see her becoming numb and rigid in long and dreary years. See the hardness, coldness, darkness in her soul soften, warm, and brighten. Anticipate even by a silent motion in the picture itself, the future when the ice will fully break, life flower again, and Penelope come to know that the beggar is Odysseus himself. Thus the image of the approaching spring entwines and relates to one another the implicit features of Penelope's inner life and makes their impact visible. This is the function of the metaphor. Here the tertium is expressed not in single traits or in their piecemeal aggregate. So he's so clear and so keen about trying to get you to see that what's dramatized here, what's expressed here, is the Gestalt. So add the word Gestalt to the Stimmung. Gestalt is the German word for structure. And it's a terrific word because we don't tend to think in structures or in what now is called systems theory, which is an effort to grasp wholes rather than their aggregate parts, which is the usual approach, namely to take things apart and analyze it. That's the subject-object dilemma. Subject-object sat on a wall, subject-object had a big fall, and all the king's horses and all the king's men could not put subject-object together again. Well, he's saying here that in Homer, there's no subject-object split. There's this inner unity that the tertium expresses that makes these kind of comparisons possible so that they so it amounts to the revelation of Penelope's soul. So this is the Homeric soul. Before there is a word for one. And that's maybe why it's so difficult to express, because it's so implied. You have to stick with this. You have to stay with this. You have to apprehend it with the kind of fidelity that Rietzler does that, for me, is unique in the history of criticism. I just tell you, funny experience I had. I was so taken by this analysis of this simile that I went and bought the Cooper edition of 1791. I showed you the copies I have, two of the four volumes. I couldn't find another simile in the four volumes that compared to this. And it, when you read it in the current translations, you don't get any of this. So what? How do you explain that? Okay, so maybe I didn't work hard enough. I got to go back and look some more. The one of Euphorbus, that's beautiful. That's the other example he gives. Another example, Euphorbus, who, you know, like a cherry tree with its blossoms, and so is his ringlets, is now like the cherry tree ripped from its roots and lying there in the ground. So lies Euphorbus. And he gives some analysis to that as well. That's a quite easy one. I'll give you a real strange one on that. I was reading the life of Apollonius of Tyana, who is a Greek figure who was resurrected. But there's an example other than the Christ, as far as resurrection is concerned. There's probably any number of them, but Apollonius of Tyana was one of them. And in his life, it's stated that Pythagoras was a reincarnation of Euphorbus. Now figure that one out.
Can you say that one more time?
Huh?
Can you say that one more time?
Yeah, really? Well, the Greeks, we're into reincarnation. And so here's Euphorbus. That's not a very central figure to the Iliad. I think it's the first day he's fighting. And Menelaus gets him and gives it to him in his neck. And there he lies. And you get this touching simile that expresses his demise. As the luxuriant olive tree by a swain reared in some solitude where rills abound puts forth her buds and fanned by genial airs on all sides hangs her boughs with whitest flowers, but by a sudden whirlwind from its trench uptorn it lies extended on the field. Such was Euphorbus of the ash spear. So he goes on after talking about that one. Again, the mutual animation of comparison and narrative is manifest. The cared-for olive tree, cooled by gentle winds, its white blossoms shining, now uprooted and knocked down, embraces in the unity of a visible image both the care, pride, and grief of the parents and the beauty, tenderness, and end of youth. Now Euphorbus' death and Penelope's tears are no longer only death and tears as facts, but life itself as a whole of intertwined forces and motions that permeate man and nature, soul and world alike. The single event is no longer merely one of many events in space and time. It is what it represents and becomes transparent. A whole lives in the part, and this whole is the way of things, nature herself, the structure of man's existence, or whatever term you prefer. You got to hang on to that in order to get to being, because that's what being is. This whole, this unitive principle, and the tertium is a wonderful step on the way to being because of its unitive character, because it is transparent to itself so that it shines through and you see it. Namely, what he finally says is the depth of Penelope's soul. He says, here a kind of miracle is achieved. The two narratives in this simile bestow life on each other. Penelope's tears animate the melting of the inanimate snow, but the inanimate returns doubly the life it receives. As to the first animation, her tears, we may stammer something about anthropomorphism, taking a term for an explanation. Moreover, the greater miracle is the second animation. It's for the sake of this second animation that Homer inserts the comparison. How can a dead process give life to a live one? Even for us today, when rivers and mountains no longer possess souls. So that's what panpsychism means in the ancient world. Everything is alive. Everything is ensouled, which is what panpsychism means. And that's an extremely important term for you to take into account for the ancient world, because that's what gets vaporized in the turn represented by Galileo and the disenchantment of nature by virtue of mathematizing it and the triumph of mathematical physics. So I didn't finish the point, Alex. Euphorbus, for some reason, is considered to be reincarnated as Pythagoras. You know, and so all I could do is go, what? Where does that come from? Well, it's obviously some kind of ancient legend. And why such a kind of minor, secondary figure in the Iliad, why should he be the reincarnation as Pythagoras? I don't know. Who was one of the most important figures of pre-Socratic philosophy? In a way, the founder of Western mathematics. And who had a cult-like sect of which he was the master. I mean, it was a religious order that developed around Pythagoras. And they had their respective rituals and rites. So, anyhow, I wanted to go through these steps with you in order to hopefully give you a sense of how important this simile is under the analysis of Kurt Rietzler. The image of the approaching spring achieves what he calls a miracle by just this concatenation of movement. That is the true tertium. Life is neither the dark nor the bright, neither the hard nor the soft. Separated and put side by side, they are dead. Life is the dark that brightens, the hard that softens, the rigid that breaks. It is all of them in one, their mutual movement towards one another. The image of the melting snow entwines them together. They live, they have their being through their relation to one another as limbs of a single body. Since they are at once sensations of our senses, states or moods of our soul, and properties of objective things, they endow the soul with a body, the body with a soul, give life to the dead, and make visible the invisible. This is the miracle not only of Homer's comparison, but of art. This is what the snow-covered mountains, the wind, and the swelling river do for the poet. Needless to say, the movements of the language, qualities of consonants and vowels, rhythm and sound of syllables and words, accompany the movement of soul and image. The ears guiding the eyes, the ears. So he goes on to give you a real key to what he's talking about here. And the key is what he comes up with. I'll read you the paragraph. Here again, none of the usual tertia that are only the common qualities of these tertia, nor their aggregate, only their impact is the unity of a dynamic structure. We may try one further step. The tertia have a specific character. They are not mere properties common to both comparison and narrative. They all belong to a group of qualities that apply to the human soul as well as to material things, and thus are common both to subject and object. This is a very interesting group of qualities for which the current nomenclature supplies no satisfactory name. Psychologists speak of intermodal sense qualities. How do you like that? That's what's at stake here. Jung called it synesthesia. That's the kind of experience people get under acid or a psychedelic, where you start to smell colors and you hear whatever. You know, intermodal sense qualities. It's a terrific term. I looked it up and you get articles on it.
So are hallucinogens just unlocking of the brain then?
Yeah. So yeah, see, we have exactly these locks that protect our perception from the flood of input that occurs when you take a psychedelic. The barriers collapse and you're bombarded and overwhelmed by this plethora of imagery and sensation, and you can hardly bear it, especially if it lasts 8 to 10 hours. And so I think that's one reason why this term and this pursuit, along with Jung's synesthesia, have become a matter of interest to people, because they're now able to experience it the way it maybe was a kind of common property in the archaic period, before subject-object and cognition and the cogito became all dominant, leading to technical reasoning. And we lost these capacities for bewilderment and wonder and mystification and so on.
If opening your brain, it seems like it would be a good thing, then why is there such a negative stigma towards psychoactive drugs?
Because it gets dangerous. Very dangerous.
You know how ambivalent it is. I mean, I was with the Leary Group at Harvard, so it's a good question to ask me. So I saw what happened. You know, and we all felt, whoa, you know, that's probably the most amazing experience I've ever had in my entire life. I took LSD maybe 2 or 3 times. I took psilocybin 2x. I took mescaline 1x. And I thought, you know, and I saw guys in my own group, in the Leary group, who worked at it so hard that they take acid and go and teach a class. And I thought, boy, are you kidding me? I mean, that's how much they tried to bring the experience under control. Anyhow.
Without prolonging this diversion, Paul, I think it's necessary to say that there are some people Paul knows well, in particular around Santa Cruz, who are damaged brains.
Yeah, catastrophes.
From too much acid.
So that's when it came home to me when I came here to teach. This campus was begun as a refuge for people in order to take drugs. That was clearly the case, and it started in 1965. So in the late 60s, you know, it was de rigueur. I used to call it the tyranny of being hip. You had to turn on, you had to drop out, you know, and you had to get hip. And everybody was under the pressure of taking psychoactive drugs here on the campus. And then you started to get the casualties, which we had already experienced at Harvard, people who simply did not make a clean re-entry. And for some of them, they were out forever. They had to open up a new category of social security in the state here in California to provide $750 a month for life for people who had become, in effect, wards of the state because they hadn't made a re-entry. They were psychedelic casualties. So when you see that happen to one student, let alone a dozen or so, yeah, you realize how ambiguous it is and how prohibitive it should be for some people because they destroy their lives accordingly. So that's how ambivalent it is. So that's why the government has been so hard on it and restricting it, and why it persists as an underground activity. It's interesting to see how completely integrated it became here on this campus. So, it, you know, now it's just, you know, commonplace. And in the early years, in the late 60s, it was interesting to watch how the administration, especially at this college, with Page Smith in charge, being as benign as he was and his cohorts in caring for students. I mean, they knew that there was nothing they could do to stop it. There wasn't any point in being especially punitive and nasty about it. They were supportive. And the word was around that if you were having a bad trip, you went into the dining hall and there were a dozen students that, who would talk you down and take care of you. That's how it was. It was an amazingly supportive community. So now it's integrated enough, I suppose, so that nobody makes a big deal out of it, right? And you have, you know, the one event that you just passed that celebrates the fact that ain't nobody's business what I do.
420.
Which I've never attended, partly to my regret, but my wife won't let me. Maybe next year. Yeah.
No, I was just going to next year, yeah.
Okay, now, I mean, are you getting this a little bit? I mean, you see what he's driving at? You see how painstaking he is about trying to give expression to you what really is very difficult to say, and what he has recourse to saying it can't be said, because he's trying to grasp the whole of this and show how Homer gives expression to the whole of Penelope's fate. So, intermodal sense qualities mean such qualities as hard and soft, warm and cold, clear and dull, that seem not to be restricted to one of our five senses as other qualities are. I can't enter into the difficult and controversial problem of the nature of sense qualities that transcend any single sense. We can try to avoid the difficulty by assuming either that the qualities are different and only their names the same, or that we simply transfer to the ears what belongs to the eyes and speak only metaphorically about warm and cold colors. The sameness of the names or the possibility of such transference remains to be explained. And he goes on to quote Goethe, that this tertium factor is for Goethe a secret correspondence that links an unknown law in the subject to an unknown law in the object. And that, for me, is the archaic smile. The unity of subject and object before it's been split. And what are they smiling about? They're smiling about the tertium. This deep, unitive aspect that shines through the surface. The poet unlocks them. It is through, in, and with one another that they live and are concrete. The real tertium is the particular pattern of their interlacing, which in comparison and narrative is analogous, that is, of corresponding structure. We do not come any nearer in Homer's wisdom, perhaps, but perhaps we do by nearing his beauty. This tertium is, in a certain way, a primum. So get that. You know, from the third thing that constitutes the basis for the comparison is the primum, like the primary unitive principle. It is obviously the function of the comparison to detach us from the object as object. The poet induces us to look away from Penelope to the snow-covered mountains, from the dying euphorbus to the uprooted olive tree. It is not the objective event, the fact qua fact, but an image, you know, in the sense of image, something that has its meaning shining through it. The fact as manifestation of something far greater than itself. The object, event, or fact becomes transparent. What in such transparency is visible is a primum and not a tertium. Both comparison and narrative, the mountain and Penelope, the olive tree and the dying youth, object, event, or fact, serve this primum and its transparence. Call this primum whatever you like. Phusis, that's the Greek word for nature. What grows, the way of things, as the first Greek philosophers called it, or Goethe's unknown correspondence, or life, or the structure of human existence. Each of these terms is but a name and preliminary. In the context of this inquiry, I prefer not to choose a term whose connotations predecides the philosophical problem into which the study cannot enter, although it intends to lead to its threshold. That's why he holds back from using the word being. But he wants to take you up to the threshold of it, so that you can move from the primum, that is more than the tertium, because of what is allowed to be expressed, to the vision of being. Okay, one last paragraph where we're done with this. The comparison, whatever it does for the narrative, has to be understood from what the narrative itself achieves as poetry. The story itself, with or without comparison, is life manifested. Existence as the whole of a dynamic structure made translucent, invisible images. If you can grasp that, then you got it. Existence as the whole of a dynamic structure made translucent, invisible images. The story proceeds, events change, but this change itself is but a change of aspects, in each of which this dynamic structure is visible as a whole. To this end, the metaphor serves the narrative in manifold ways. So that's, I think, as close as we can get to understanding the archaic smile. What are they smiling about? Some kind of anticipation of the vision of being, if it's not as yet given. They're somehow in tune with its first glimpse. You don't know how to talk about it. You know, like, there's something enigmatic. It's so close to what Heidegger, the philosopher of the last century, calls unconcealedness, or disclosure, or what's hidden and yet made manifest. I mean, he's very close in his analysis of early Greek thought to exactly what Rietzler does in his interpretation of this Homeric simile. And he really does a kind of pathology of our mentality when he talks about how incapable or how lacking we are in being able to understand this, what we're talking about today. Because we suffer from what he calls the oblivion of being. I mean, we've forgotten so much. It's such a massive forgetfulness that whenever Heidegger writes the word being, he writes it crossed out. So here's a guy in the 20th century who talks about how the whole progression from the Greek wonder before the mystery of being has been so dissipated and so demystified and so disenchanted that we now suffer from forgetfulness to the point of oblivion. And where being is canceled and therefore written is crossed out.
So I'm interested in whether, have you ever read any texts on like memory and memory loss and experiments done like that? Because I remember reading a book, I think it was by Oliver Sacks or something.
Could have been, yeah.
But there's a lot of research into that whole concept of people who can't form new thoughts or they have no memory of anything that's ever happened to them. And you know what that means for their souls, or what that means is like, are they even a, what we would define as a person, a human being, because of it?
We saw one that's comparable to that on 60 Minutes, where there are certain people that develop a condition where they can't identify faces.
Oh yeah.
Even their own children. So it's a funny, you know, extension
well,
that, of
that. That's kind of a like a, what do you call it?
Aphasia is the word for memory loss.
Yeah, but I was trying to think, oh, Alzheimer's, that's what I was trying
yeah,
to
think. Yeah, it's comparable to that too. Or to the operation known as prefrontal lobotomy.
That
renders you kind of blank.
Out, yeah.
Yeah, so they used to do that a lot.
Yeah.
As a way of treating mental illness.
In the most, like shocking people.
Exactly. It was another form of shock therapy, but it was this, it was a, you know, they excised the prefrontal lobe, and that just calmed people down and made them, you know, basically kind of manageable for sure, and utterly reduced.
But it also took away, like, what kind of made them human beings.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
They talk about how you have dramatic changes in personality after that, to the point where...
So if you wanted, you know, if you really wanted to say what Heidegger's talking about, he's saying that we've all had prefrontal lobotomies performed on us. When it comes to the mystery of being. So, you know, Hamlet says to be or not to be. Well, yeah. I mean, what does that mean? Whether 'tis nobler in the mind, he goes on to say, or suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against it. So he takes it off into the, you know, like the contemplative and the active life, which was a big theme in Western culture. So Hamlet goes from to be or not to be, you know, as the kind of the ultimate almost outcry, so, and not even a question, it's a kind of outcry, to talk about whether to be contemplative or active. And then he decides for the former as far as these soliloquies, where he's at a loss as to what to do because he's encountered the ghost of his father and he doesn't know whether he should trust the ghost. For good reason. And when he finally acts, he kills Polonius, the father of Ophelia and Laertes. Ah, shit. Who's standing behind a curtain. You know, and that's what he gets for finally acting. And that drives Ophelia insane and so on. So Hamlet's a good one about the... giving expression to the perplexity of to be or not to be. And that became one of the great lines of Shakespeare. So Heidegger said, well, you know, you can try to discuss this. He took great pains through his whole philosophical career to understand the meaning of being in the face of realizing its cancellation. You know, and so what you get left with, in a way, for 20th century thought, is the dilemma of existence. Once being goes, then existence becomes a big quandary, because it's like it's lost its ground. in the move from being to existence. So existence becomes the big predicament after the loss of the meaning of being. My teacher Tillich characterized Western culture by way of three major periods of anxiety. What he called the anxiety of non-being. What kind of expression did it take? In the ancient world, it was the anxiety of fate and death. That's how the anxiety of non-being gave expression to itself. And in the late ancient world, you know, after the classic period of ancient Greece, this huge mood fell over ancient culture of fate, and then behind it, death. There's a good word my wife and I have just cottoned on to, ineluctable, which is a word for fate and necessity. Ineluctable, Google it. Take it into your vocabulary. It's a really good word. Fated necessity. That's a tragedy. That's Hamlet. Has to happen the way it did. Because it's ineluctable. There's something lurking in that word too, which means it's inexpressible. It's uncanny. You can't grasp it. It has to be shown. Hey, so that's a nice move. Look at what gets shown here. And when you get to the tragedies, you can't say it because it's inexpressible. It has to be shown, which is why it's a drama. And so when Oedipus blinds himself when he finally sees, that has to be shown. You can't say it. You can't talk about it. It's ineluctable. So fate and death is the anxiety of non-being in the ancient world. Guilt and condemnation, the anxiety of the Reformation world at the time of the Renaissance. Guilt and condemnation. I'm a Lutheran. Hey, ain't any better way to put it than that, as far as I'm concerned. And what's the current one? How is the anxiety of non-being expressed in the modern period, according to Tillich? Emptiness and meaninglessness.
Sarge.
No kidding. And existence is the quandary in industrial society. So, it's a bleak outcome of this whole run that we're starting out with. Okay, here's Athena. Born from the forehead of Zeus, and she was outfitted just like that. She had her helmet on. And her spear. And this is, you know, variously thought of as Zeus or Poseidon throwing his spear. And it's, you know, it's just magnificent, huge bronze sculpting. I've seen it at the museum in Athens. And they've got another one at the UN. There he is. Holy smokes. That's, you know, clearly one of the greatest of all images from ancient Greece. And, you know, I showed you how stiff and formalized the archaic sculptings are, and then how, as the classic period comes on, how infinitely subtle and dynamic the figures
That's
become.
That's Apollo, perhaps?
Huh?
This is Apollo?
Well, I don't think so. It's a youth. It's not Apollo. I've got one of Apollo, but it's kind of formalized. Apollo is called He Who Shoots From Afar. Here he is. So you get the epithets of Apollo, you know, of distance, of he who shoots from afar. He can see things in perspective from a, you know, the gaze that he has. So those are the attributes of Apollo, and his also being an expression of rationality. So here they are. It's a few of them anyhow. The pre-Socratic philosophers, da-da! So now we start with the guys who really try to think it through, or at least begin to, if not through, to start it out. And here's the list. And it's, I want you to memorize their names. Come on, you can do it. I did it. If I can do it, you can do it. And the reason why I want you to memorize it, because when you hit any moment of the need for something really distracting, you'd be able to recite these to yourself. Thales, Anaximander, Anaximenes, Xenophanes, Parmenides, Heraclitus, Democritus, Anaxagoras, Empedocles, see what I mean? So, you know, starts in the 6th century. You can call this the miracle of Greek thought. I'm willing to say that. They're still perplexed why it should have happened the way it did, and how, in some sense, they turn against the mythical background, and especially Homer. So Thales is the first of the pre-Socratics, and the last, the 7th, of the 7 wise men of Greece. You know, when I was first starting this, I thought, well, how come Thales is the first thinker? Were there anybody, any guys before him? Yeah, the 7 wise men of Greece. And he was one of those. So he's the transition from them to the pre-Socratic philosophers. Now, the 7 wise men were the guys that said it would be better never to have been born, and having once been born, to die right away. They're pretty melancholic. They could have just as well been Norwegians. You know, I have Norwegian ancestors, and they're very melancholic. They sit around in a room and go, they can't even say yeah. They go, it's a real experience to be in a room of Norwegian relatives, and it goes around a room like that. Oh, brother. So the 7 wise men are famous for this melancholy utterance about the futility of human existence. And it's pretty much expressed in one of my favorite Greek words, ephemeros, from which we get the word ephemeral. And ephemeros is often translated as creatures of a day, as if one day is it. We give birth astride a grave. The light gleams for an instant and then no more. Isn't that enough for you? So, creatures of a day. It's the first line of a famous poem of Pindar, the 4th Pythian ode. Ephemeroi, creatures of a day. What is anyone? What is anyone not? Man is a shadow in a dream. But when God casts his brightness, shining light is on earth and life is sweet as honey. So you have it both ways in ancient Greece, not just the 7 wise men, and not just ephemerality as the briefness of existence characterized by a day from birth to death, but also the shining brightness that's on earth. And there was nothing more evident and glorious in Greece than the sun and its shining. So we got Thales as the last of the 7 and the first of what? About 15. And he was famous for saying water. Thereafter, what the basic principle is. And the word for principle is arche, A-R-C-H-A-E, as in the archaic smile. So we go from the smile to the effort to find out, what is it? How do you express it? Is there some, I don't want to call it material, but that's what it is. They were called physicists. But you got to remember the Greek word for physis, for nature, physis, means what grows. So they want to know what is it that is the unitive principle of what we observe and experience. So Thales says it's water. And he means the metaphysical water, what we would maybe call the waters of baptism, or the waters we swam in when we were in the womb, in the amniotic fluid, and how critical water is for life. So that's the first word of Greek philosophy, water. And then you get Anaximander, who gives us the first prose sentence of Greek philosophy. And it's awesome. I remember I taught a course on this with Tillich at Harvard. And when he expressed and quoted the words of Anaximander, the whole class acted like they were hearing it from the horse's mouth. I mean, he had this German accent that added a kind of gloss to what he said. You know, made it sound even wiser than it was. And he had this very kind of rhythmical and almost hypnotic way of speaking. And so when he recited Anaximander, it was awesome. Likewise, when he recited the poem of Parmenides. Because he knew it, you know. He had imbibed it and internalized it so that you got the sense that you were hearing it as it needed to be heard. So the first sentence, I don't even have it front of me. Yes, I do. This is the critical text, by the way, in case you want to carry through on any of this. The Pre-Socratic Philosophers by Kirk and Raven. They're all in here. And they're fun to refer to and to get to know to some extent, because this is where it started. So you're one up on everybody if you know this stuff. You know, you can turn any dinner conversation to, well, you know, are you aware of what Heraclitus said about the Logos? Well, let me tell you. You know what Logos means? So here's what Anaximander said. Now, what's so odd? We don't have the words of any of them firsthand, of course. So how do we get them? Well, we get them through other sources. So you have somebody like Simplicius, who says this is what he said. Or from Hippolytus, this is what he said. Or from Pseudo-Plutarch. So the transmission of the sayings of the pre-Socratic philosophers comes through this odd kind of scholarly apparatus that we have to learn something about, because that's the source that gives us what it is they said. So you have to trust it to the extent that you have to, because there's no other retrieval of these words. And so you get three versions, somewhat of the same, from these three different sources as they're cited here, and there are other sources as well. Of those who say that it is one, moving, and infinite, Anaximander said that the principle and element of existing things was the apeiron, A-P-E-I-R-O-N, nearly untranslatable term. It means, you know, what things come from. Sometimes it's called the receptacle. Sometimes it's called the indefinite. What it comes from, what things come from the apeiron. So it's a very abstract term, and it's an abstract concept, and it's not an image, unless you want to say receptacle. That gives you a kind of image. If you say indefinite or infinite, yeah, you don't exactly know what to make of that. So this is a perfect example of what thought is reaching to get out of the Homeric world of imagery and narrative play. He says it is neither water nor any other of the so-called elements, but some other apeiron nature, from which come into being all the heavens and the worlds in them. And this is where it comes into play. And the source of coming to be for existing things is that into which destruction too happens according to necessity. And the source of coming to be for existing things is that into which destruction too happens. So you get the tragic cycle of Genesis and decay. And they pay penalty and retribution to each other for their injustice, according to the assessment of time, as he describes it in these rather poetical terms. So there's also an issue of tragic guilt that coming into being entails, and you have to pay the penalty accordingly. And this is cosmic guilt. This isn't anything that you've done that for which you're accused and for which you're guilty. This is the nature of things. There's a sense of cosmic guilt as a consequence of being individuated. It's reminiscent of Kafka. You know, you have the sense of being guilty, but you don't know why or who's accusing you or even what the accusation is. That's another major mood in the ancient world. And it's picked up by the Orphics, who make a play on the Greek word for body and prison. The word for body is soma. The word for prison is sema. So it's considered that the soul has fallen into the body prison and we long to escape. That's how existence is viewed. And it's reminiscent of this saying of Anaximander that we have to pay the penalty because of the injustice that we have undergone with respect to one another. One line, and it's a summary line. I'm reminded of Suzuki Roshi, who brought Zen Buddhism to San Francisco, and whose characteristic image was to do this. Just to draw this circle in the air. And it wasn't quite attached, but it's like the saying of Anaximander, what things come out of, they have to go back to. And they have to pay the penalty according to the order of time for the injustice that they've done to one another. So existence is some kind of monstrous tribunal that we enter without knowing what the guilt's about, because it's cosmic. And, you know, in a way we call that fatalism. That's ineluctable. So that's Anaximander. He's a good one. Then comes Anaximenes. And he says it's what? You guys know? Air. But it's a cosmic air. Remember how psyche is breathing? And so you can have a kind of world soul that is also air-like, an extension, or, you know, they mutually relate to one another. I mean, it's an extension of the Homeric understanding of psyche as breath, but poured out at death. And when Anaximenes says air as the main principle, he means something cosmic by way of air, just as Thales meant something cosmic by way of water.
Universal consciousness, perhaps?
Yeah, that was all involved because of logos. You know, the Greeks thought language was something that grasped reality and it had a cosmic implication. It wasn't just what was in human language or inside your head. There is a logos structure to what is, which enabled you to think about it and grasp it in language. And the word logos means to speak and to say. But we've reduced it to, you know, talking and thinking in a flat sense, you know, where words are markers, as opposed to the Greeks, who were close to the notion that saying so made it so.
Didn't Heidegger also kind of share those beliefs? Heidegger,
yeah.
I thought, also kind of seemed to share.
Yeah, he wants to go back to that. And that's his understanding of language. And that's why he's so stuck on the notion that language is what discloses things, and unconcealedness, this unintelligible way of translating his German terms for what is hidden and still manifest. That's what Logos grasps. It's making manifest. It's this kind of luminous presence that is so clearly indicated here in Rietzler's discussion, and it gets dissipated and flattened the more thinking turns to the exploitation of nature instead of the kind of sacramental revelation of what nature amounts to. I told you, we got into that here with the garden. It was the great experience of my life to have a gardener here who regarded nature sacramentally. Yeah, it was almost a joke. What the hell is he doing here? He was such a throwback. They kind of tolerated him, you know? And if they had really known, I think they probably would have kicked him out of here the minute he tried to dig a bed, because he was so much in opposition to the trend that this institution represented in its drive toward physicalistic scientism. And I learned firsthand, by virtue of my association with him, what a sacramental understanding of nature meant, as opposed to a technical industrial relation. So let's take a momentary breather. Anybody want to say anything? Let's have a little discussion for a while. I'm starting to wear out. The anison is losing its kick. Our friend Marta has introduced my wife and I to anison. You guys are too young to need it. But if you ever want a perk, you take anison. It's over the counter. It's aspirin and caffeine. And they work synergistically. And then you have a double cappuccino on top of it before you come in here. And, you know, you can go for about an hour and a half.
It's no LSD.
And there isn't much after effect that we get. I don't sense any letdown at all. I only take it when I have to talk for an hour or more.
Well, my doll used to have caffeine and aspirin in it, too.
Yeah. I remember that.
Probably same thing. That's my commercial for Addison. Yeah.
Do you remember what the class was that the professor went to teach on acid?
You mean Leary? Timothy Leary? Yeah, what was the name of your class at Harvard? Or were you invited by the psychology department to come in and participate in the test? Was there a class that...
No. It was just people that gravitated to Leary. He had his own research group around him. And it was the psilocybin prison project that was the issue at the time. They used psilocybin, they gave it to convicts in prisons. And Leary was a big proponent of game theory. And so the issue was to give you psilocybin, give you a real strong psychedelic experience so that you had some insight into yourself and the games you were playing, specifically the convict game. And the issue was to kick you out of that and give you a new start on a better game.
Did it work?
Yeah, they had great success. Partly due to the fact that they followed guys up as thoroughly as they did to try to minimize their recidivism, which was huge. You know, like 80% of the guys went back to jail within a short period of time. So that was one of the measures of their success, is to kind of keep the guys out of jail that had undergone the experience. So that was the thing. So then there are other people like me who heard about it because Leary wanted to depart from the going model that it induced a psychosis. That's how it was treated by psychiatrists. If you wanted to know what it was to go insane, you took LSD. Perfect training for for understanding insanity. And Lear didn't like the psychotomimetic theme. He wanted it to be a model mystical experience for the purpose of transforming your life. So he called it mystico-mimetic. So then he reached out to people at the divinity school, like moi. And so we played along. And it led to this famous Good Friday experiment by my colleague Walter Pankey, who was a MD, but also a student at Harvard Divinity School and graduate school. And he organized about 20 graduates, 20 divinity students to take psilocybin on a Good Friday afternoon at Marsh Chapel at Boston University in order to provide them with a mystical experience that would help them with their ministry, assuming that they didn't have one. That was fun. I was involved in that experiment. I unfortunately got the placebo, which was tartaric acid that gave you prickly heat, and I knew that that was not a mystical experience. So, that's the Leary stuff. What did you ask?
What class he taught.
Oh, I don't know. No, these were the guys. Gunther Weil was one guy that comes to mind who is with Leary. He's the one I know who would take acid and go and teach.
What did he teach?
He taught psychology. So, that was just how extreme they were in testing out the effort to control their behavior under the drug, which just, you know, I couldn't believe that anybody could do that. But they did. I went to a concert with him once at MIT. It was Ravi Shankar. And he taught me that the tuning up was the whole concert before the concert, because he was high at that. He took acid before he went to the concert. So the first, you know, he went, So, you know, I thought, yeah, we're missing the whole concert before the concert, because everybody was talking and not paying attention until the concert started. Well, there was the whole, I mean, it was like Ravi Shankar was taking you through the history of the instrument before he started to play it. Then when I went to the Boston Symphony and they were all tuning up, that became a concert for me. Yeah? But there is a famous example of a baseball player in the major leagues who on a day off took acid, and then they called him in to pitch. And he pitched the perfect game. That's a famous story. And he would describe, you know, when he threw the ball, you know, it would go like this. So he could just, you know, everybody, you know, batted out on him. Yeah, Mary.
Well, there's some people, when they hear music, they also see colors related to the
Yeah,
pitch.
That's exactly intermodal sense quality, synesthesia. And so let's say that that was a real attribute of ancient response, that they had that in spades in a way that is relatively unique now because of the controls on our perception. That's real interesting to think about. And I told Alex, I gave him this book for his birthday, and there's a section in the book that really surprised me. I hadn't really thought of that before. Friends of mine had a son, and when he was about 3 or 4 years old, he confused a figure on horseback, a bronze sculpting, with a real person on a horse. It's kind of like a kid being confused about whether Santa Claus is a real person or a, you know, somebody impersonating Santa Claus. And there's a period of time in your youth where you don't know the difference. You think that's Santa Claus. And finally you kind of, oh yeah, you might even identify or recognize the guy. And so there's a period in ancient Greece coming off of Homer where images were like icons, and where the meaning that they expressed was shining through them. So there wasn't any notion that this was a statue or a figure or an image, an object, And then slowly the perception shifts as if the culture grows up like a kid And Santa Claus becomes, you know, a personification, an actor. You know, okay, you play along. You know, and you know better. You're not fooled anymore. And that seems to have happened in ancient Greece. It's the one of the key figures is Simonides. I told you about him last time. I mentioned his name. He's a poet who comes generations after Homer, and he says, you know, I'm not going to speak the truth. I don't get the words from the muses. I don't have to transcend myself to where the words of the poem are, thanks to the daughters of memory. No, I write poetry for money. And my poetry is opinion, not truth. Doxa. So think of that as a comparable turn from the kind of majesty and mystery of what shines through something, as opposed to seeing it as an object. You know, icons serve that purpose even today for Russian and Greek Orthodox, where the icon is the manifestation of the saint in question. Icons, in a way, are worshipped, aren't they?
Well, you kiss it when you come to the...
Yeah, you kiss it.
In front of the altar, and you bow down. And you think that
the icon is somehow the you know, the expression of the saint. And that was a big struggle over the church. You know, where that was considered to be superstitious and erroneous, and forget about it. So, you know, like Western Protestantism, especially in some of its forms, remove all images. Because it's considered to be idolatrous to think that this picture is it. So that's another interesting transitional point, namely to move from inspired poetry that is what it expresses to, hey, commission me and give me some money and you'll get a poem. And that's all it is, it's just a poem. But it may be a beautiful one. Okay, I'm going to skip Pythagoras for now to go on to Xenophanes, because he's real critical. And he's really the first theologian, although it isn't until we get to Plato that the term is coined. Plato coins the term theology. And I think partly to give expression to what appeared in Socrates. So you have Socratic theology expressed by Plato, and he coins the term. But Xenophanes is really the first theologian, and it's because of his critique of Homer. He says, get out of here. We don't believe all that anymore. The Homeric gods have to be rejected in favor of a monotheistic deity.
Really?
Yeah, no kidding. He just says, hey, wait a minute. God is one. God is immovable, doesn't run around and screw and and get into all these crazy conflicts that the gods get into. Forget all that. Homer and Hesiod tell many a lie. And what they say about the gods is unseemly. And the Greek word is epiprepi. Unseemly. That's what I told you. This guy, he said he was God up here, came to my office and told me that it was unseemly for God to go without. And I was supposed to give him 10% of my salary. And that's when I turned black like Achilles.
Did you use those words?
He used that word. I think that's partly what triggered it. It was just a funny coincidence, but he said it's unseemly for God to go without. And I thought, yeah, well, you ain't no Xenophanes, pal. So Xenophanes is a wonderful figure. And he has some great sayings. But that's where it starts. And then you get into a very definite monotheism by the time you get to Plato, where the good is the highest figure. Homer and Hesiod have attributed to the gods everything that is a shame and reproach among men, stealing and committing adultery and deceiving each other. That's one. But mortals consider that the gods are born and that they have clothes and speech and bodies like their own. It's another, forget it. The Ethiopians say that their gods are snub-nosed and black. The Thracians, that theirs have light blue eyes and red hair. But if cattle and horses or lions had hands or were able to draw with their hands and do the works that men can do, horses would draw the forms of the gods like horses and cattle like cattle, and they would make their bodies such as they each had themselves. So that's terrific, you know, that somebody is starting to think about it in just that way. And one God, greatest among gods and men, in no way similar to mortals, either in body or in thought. Always he remains in the same place, moving not at all. Nor is it fitting for him to go to different places at different times. But without toil, he shakes all things by the thought of his mind. All of him sees, all thinks, and all hears. Isn't that nice? That's the Xenophanes. So, he goes on to have many more sayings, especially about cosmology and the nature of the universe and so on. And they're all trying to work that out one after another. I told you part of the schematic is first of all, the elements, what become the elements, they're first of all principles, like water, air, earth, and fire. And then these principles become elements the more they're abstracted from the notion that, well, no, they're not really the principle or the original source. They're more like an element along with some other elements. Yeah, earth, air, fire, and water. Okay, those are the four elements. And then they further abstract to condensation and rarefaction through the hot, the cold, the dry, and the moist. That's pretty much the grid of the original dynamic of abstraction. From earth, air, fire, and water to hot, cold, dry, moist to rarefaction and condensation.
Isn't the atomic structure formulated perhaps by Aristotle?
No, Democritus.
Say, sir, again?
Yeah, Democritus is the atomist and gives the argument that all things are made of atoms.
What's your explanation for that insight?
I don't know. He just did it. I mean, God, it's so incredible that this should have started with the Greeks rather than be, you know, more of a modern discovery. But he worked out atomism to quite a degree. Then Lucretius picks it up and continues it. And that's materialism. That's atomism. That's the basic particle that is the basic stuff. And that's Democritus' contribution to pre-Socratic philosophy, and it has this long play. Finally comes into its own in the Renaissance when Galileo reads Lucretius, who was translated for the Renaissance. It enters Renaissance Italy at the time of Galileo, and that's when atomism enters Western thought again. What?
This Democritus, sir?
Yeah. Democritus of Abdera, 460 B.C. And that's what then takes over Western science. And why it becomes materialistic, namely the reduction of things to their chemical and physical properties, or elements, or atoms. And he finally had the smashing of the atom in the squash court in Chicago when Fermi worried about destroying the universe. When in fact they had already destroyed it through the materialist philosophy. And those dirty communists who made it a national ideology, thanks to Karl Marx. I mean, what a story. You know, I've got a certain sympathy now for the anti-communist movement in this country, which was so terrible. I'm from Wisconsin. So there was no greater freak, reprehensible figure in Wisconsin politics than Joe McCarthy. But, you know, in a way you can start to see that the opposition to communism was also an opposition to the ideology of materialism, even though we bought that all the way, so what's the point? But you know, let's just say that it had some bearing on the anti-communist revolt in this country to try to, you know, resist materialism in the Russian form. I don't even know how to put it, because we're sufficiently materialist on our own that what's there to argue against? Might as well start at home. But yeah, that's a big issue. So we'll start then next time with Parmenides. So if you would please be so kind as to read the poem of Parmenides and the chariot ride to being, we're going to get there. I'm going to take you on that ride.
What is it called?
The Parmenides poem and his chariot ride to being. All you got to do is Google Parmenides and you'll get it, because it's only a page or two. It's not a long text. I mean, you can read it in 5 minutes. But pay very much attention to the imagery, if you would. I mean, it starts out with, "I was carried as far as my tumas could desire." I finally saw the Greek rendering of the poem, and there was tumas. As far as his tumas could desire, he was carried up in this chariot to the vision of being. Ride, chariot, ride. And swing low, sweet chariot. Coming forward to carry me to the vision of being, which is home. So Parmenides is a high point. So much so that there's a whole dialogue in the Platonic corpus called the Parmenides. And Plato has the young Socrates meet the old Parmenides and they talk. And that's the most difficult dialogue of all the Platonic dialogues. And I once read an article where the guy said no one has ever understood it. Which reminded me of Hegel saying, no one has ever understood what I have written except one person, and he misunderstood it. And Hegel probably meant himself. Oh, brother, isn't philosophy fun?
Now, I was reading not too long ago about like oracles in ancient Greece, and there is some hypothesis that they burned plants as part of the, you know, ceremony.
Well, they actually had some kind of burning sulfurous stuff that came up from the ground.
Right, and that
at the Delphic Oracle, and the smelling of those vapors put one into a trance.
Right, and that some of those vapors, I guess, I think it's argot or whatever it's.
Well, not. I don't think that's implicated in the Delphic Oracle stuff, but the ergot was central to the Eleusinian mysteries, and that was, you know, some form of LSD.
Right. That's what. Yeah.
Yeah. So they definitely went into a trance state, you know, in those mysteries. And at the high point of the mystery, they showed a sheaf of rye, which ergot grows on, as the kind of, you know, epiphany of the ritual ceremony. So that's all quite well known. And there's some wonderful books on that. One's called The Road to Eleusis, which is by some major classic scholars who were also very knowledgeable about current psychedelics. So that's what took them back into the ancient period to kind of unearth these motifs that are so central to the Eleusinian mysteries. And, you know, now it's known or understood what made it a matter of initiation and mystical experience. So, my darlings, we'll see you all next Wednesday.